Hey, what's up, Optimal Nation, and welcome to another episode of the Optimal Health Show. In this week's podcast, our guest is Miriam Kalamian. She is a nutritional professional specializing in ketogenic diets for cancer and other metabolic diseases. She holds a Master of Science degree in human nutrition from Eastern Michigan University. She's also earned a master's degree in education from Smith College and a bachelor's degree from Connecticut College. Wow, she's one educated person. She has a passion for helping other people implement the ketogenic diet, which comes directly from personal experiences from her own son, Rafi, who was diagnosed with brain tumor of December 2004. So I know you're going to enjoy today's podcast. But before we actually get today's episode, there's a couple of things. This week's highlighted Optimal member is Anthony Guru. Keep it up, brother. You're doing a fantastic job. The second thing is, if you haven't already, please head over to iTunes, leave a review. The more reviews we get, the more people in the world we can help. So without further ado, please sit back and relax and enjoy today's amazing podcast with Miriam Kalamian. Hey, Miriam, how are you doing?
I'm doing well. How are you today, Ameer?
I'm good. I just want to thank you so much for coming on the show. And the reason I got you on the show is I heard you on Jimmy Moore's podcast. And honest to God, I won't lie, I started crying a little bit because the passion that you had in your voice and the message you had was so profound and it hit me so deeply. And specifically how you're actually talking about your message and how you want everybody to hear your message, it really touched my heart. So that's why I have you on the show today. And we're going to be talking about, you know, your journey in the world of health and what you've been through and how certain diets, specifically the keto diet, holds great promises for people in certain situations. So before we actually begin, why don't we give our audience a quick little background about your story?
Okay, well, back in 2004, December of 2004, our son, who was 4 years old at the time, was diagnosed with a brain tumor. And as you can imagine, it was just, it's devastating. You hear that about your child and what do you do? So we initially put our faith in totally in the medical system. I hardly went online because what I saw online was just unbearable. And so we did the standard of care. And the standard of care for our little guy was 14 months of chemotherapy. He did okay with that, but it didn't stop the tumor. And 3 months after we finished that, we were being told he needed radiation. Then we were told he couldn't have radiation. And that's when we realized that that we really had, you know, we had to take a different course with this. So we opted for surgery for better or worse. We had to do something. We didn't know any better. We opted for surgery. And that didn't stop the tumor from growing. And it did a lot of damage as well. Not the surgeon's fault. It was just a huge tumor in a little boy's head. So our next move was to do a clinical trial. And at the time, I thought clinical trials were cutting edge technology and that somehow this was, this held the best hope for us for turning things around. And he failed the clinical trial. But halfway through that failed trial, we knew that this was going to happen. We had an interim MRI, and we knew it was going to happen. And right at the same time, I was so fortunate to find Thomas Seyfried's work. It had just been published. It was about the ketogenic diet, a calorie-restricted ketogenic diet, slowing progression of a mouse model of brain tumor. But the reference that he used, what he was building on was some research that had been done in the 90s by a doctoral candidate at the time named Linda Nabling. And when I actually read that paper, our world changed in a heartbeat. Our world changed. Here was a diet that not only had slowed progression in these two salvaged children, these were children who were well past standard therapies, But it had improved their nutritional status as well. So how could this, I mean, this was win-win. How could this not be something we would want to do when we really had no other viable options? So it was a struggle mentally to believe that there could be something so simple and so safe. It had been used with children for with epilepsy since the 1920s. And, you know, why weren't we aware of it before that point? But that's the water under the bridge. What we did then was study as much as we could in the couple of weeks before he was coming off the trial. I got the book from Johns Hopkins on the ketogenic diet for epilepsy for children. And even though we had our I had my anxieties. My husband was totally, this is going to be fine. But we started it with him, and it was just amazing. We couldn't physically tell in the beginning what was happening, but at his three-month MRI, now mind you, we had an MRI on the day that they pulled him from the trial. Mm. And then we had an MRI 3 months later, and his tumor had stopped growing. As a matter of fact, it had shrunk back. Hard to tell. 10 to 15% is what they're willing to say. And that hadn't happened with anything we had done to that date. So at that point, I had to know everything. Why was this diet working? What could we do to make it better? I really needed to know. So that was in June. And by August, I was enrolled in a grad program at Eastern Michigan. It was a master's program in human nutrition. And although I was definitely outside that box, everything I studied was classic nutrition, but I was always searching for why a very low carbohydrate, high fat diet might change the picture. And we continued with the diet with our son. We did the diet with him for 3 years. And he had an amazingly good quality of life with it. We came to take it for granted in some ways, but I continued to study and learn, and even started to get out there with it prior to getting my degree. But ultimately for him, he had a lot of structural damage. He had a huge tumor, and he did start a bit of a slide. And we had 3 years of a real roller coaster ride, and he just died in April. But it's important, very important to note that he did not die because his tumor got larger. He died because there was structural damage to some very delicate things in the brain. And he couldn't live any longer and with those structural changes. So That's how I got into it. And so that's why I'm so passionate about it, because here's this non-toxic dietary approach to accomplishing something that we weren't able to do with conventional care. It is not a cure, but it is certainly a great adjunct therapy. And I feel very strongly that in the years to come, the researchers that are investigating other non-toxic metabolic therapies are going to be able to come up with a combination of things that are going to do a lot more than, improve a lot more than 3 years or some people, the limited amount of time they might gain benefit from this. And also will make it easier for people as far as the compliance end of it. And I don't mean compliance in a strong-willed, disciplined kind of way. I just mean the ability to stick to a very low-carb diet over a period of time. This is lower this is lower carb than what Volek and Finney propose in their low-carbohydrate living and low-carbohydrate performance books, which I recommend to everybody. I think they're wonderful books. But, they're working at about 50 grams of carb. A lot of my clients need to start in order to get into that therapeutic zone very quickly. They need to start pretty low at 12 to 15 grams of net carbs per day. It's nice to think that at some point, which is what we did with our son, we were able to liberalize the diet and still have the good effects from it. But for some, it is that low. For other people who are compromised, and I'll tell you, I work with people who are already in hospice care. And I do design the diet differently.
What are the effects have you seen for those clients in hospice care?
I think it depends on how close they are to end of life, really. If they're within days or weeks, this is not really going to be anything they can use. But I see a mental clarity, and I see more enjoyment of life. So it's more about quality of life at that point. If I can get somebody before they begin the standard of care, if I could start working with somebody before they begin the standard of care, then they can sail through that a whole lot differently. And over time, I think that's where we're going to see the real improvements. Getting somebody after a recurrence, we're starting to work with somebody after a recurrence, and now they have elevated liver enzymes, or they have anemia, or they have low blood counts, or they have impaired GI motility, or they're on steroid drugs or opioids. When you get to that point, it complicates the picture. But I still feel very strongly that people have improved quality of life with a diet than if they were to continue feeding their tumors with all those refined sugars, refined starches, sugars, all the things that people with cancer are generally told to eat.
Yeah, I agree. So what's the underlying mechanism exactly going on with the keto diet and reduction or the stoppage of the growth of the tumor?
Okay. Most cancers are very glucose avid. And by that I mean they have a need for a lot more glucose because they're running it much less efficiently. Instead of being able to process glucose in the healthy mitochondria of the cell, the mitochondria has been compromised in some way. There's lots of ways that it can be compromised. So instead of a healthy cell utilizing glucose in a normal way, the glucose that's entering the cell is primarily fermented in the cytoplasm. It never makes it into the mitochondria of the cell. And it's very inefficient, and it produces a lot of metabolic waste. And what you do with a ketogenic diet, by limiting the carbohydrates that in that way, there's a couple of different things that are happening. You know, first, by limiting carbohydrate, you're limiting the amount of glucose that enters the bloodstream. So it's about the glucose spikes. After a meal with a lot of carbohydrate, it's normal for your glucose to spike. It can go 20, 30, 40 points, no problem. And with that spike comes a spike in insulin. So not only is there more glucose available in the bloodstream, but there's more insulin in the bloodstream, and that insulin is pushing the glucose into these cells via transporters. And important to note that there are a lot more of these glucose transporters on cancer cells than there are normal cells, exactly for that purpose, because the cancer cells are glucose avid, they're greedy, they need a lot more glucose to feed them, so they have a lot more of these receptors. The other thing that happens when you cut down on the carbohydrates is you enter that state of nutritional ketosis. You make this metabolic shift away from glucose insulin dependence on maintaining glucose levels in your bloodstream towards this system that is going to utilize fats instead. It's a wonderful backup system for us historically. And even present day, if you go for a period of time without eating, if you were totally dependent on the glucose that was coming from your food, you wouldn't last very long. So there's all kinds of backup mechanisms that we have that will produce glucose even in the absence of dietary carbohydrate. But one of the things that happens with that restriction, like I said, is you shift to ketosis, your body begins to convert fats into ketone bodies, and it also becomes more efficient at using other dietary and mobilized fats. So that, you know, beta oxidation increases. And then you also find, you know, amino acids can play into feeding healthy tissue, but also, unfortunately, feeding cancer tissue. Mm.
So what is the connection? Because I've seen in my studies and research the effects that glucose has a hard time with the blood-brain barrier, and the fact that ketones have, they can go in and out of the blood-brain barrier quite easily, right?
Oh, they don't require a transporter. Mm. Glucose requires a transporter in order for it to cross the cell membrane. That actually becomes problematic as we get older. But for people with cancer, this is where it sort of started with the brain cancer world. Ketones being able to just diffuse across cell membranes would protect the healthy brain tissue, but the tumor tissue is not. It doesn't use glucose very well. This is true of tumor tissue anywhere in the body, so it can't use those ketones as efficiently as it would glucose, and so they become even more compromised.
That's amazing. So you would summarize then. For example, the GLU4s or GLU2 receptors inside the cell is not necessary for ketones to be utilized as energy.
Absolutely not. They just diffuse across the cell membrane. They do not need a transporter. They're short. They're a short molecule, and they readily diffuse. So they bypass that whole issue with the blood-brain barrier, but they also are more readily taken up by other tissue as well, like heart and skeletal muscle. Mm. Loves ketones.
Interesting. Earlier, you were talking about the difference between, for example, your approach on ketosis and what was the other author?
Volokh and Finney.
Yeah, Volokh and Finney. And there's a kind of a difference. You guys have a different approach within the grammage. Can you just kind of more indulge us on that aspect of your approach versus theirs? Because you're doing it more for therapeutic, as they are doing it for maybe more athletic.
Well, they are also metabolic researchers, so they feel very strongly that this is beneficial for metabolic diseases like diabetes and metabolic syndrome, polycystic ovarian syndrome. But they start at a higher point because they have the luxury of starting there. The cells aren't going to, there aren't any cells around that are highly glucose avid and are going to proliferate and as cancer. So it's not a difference in any mechanism. It's just a difference in where we start. Like I said, people with metabolic diseases generally have more luxury in what they do and what the level of ketones are going to be. The level of ketones at 50 grams of carbohydrate a day are not going to be anywhere near the ketone levels at 12 grams. And ketones may have an independent effect on for killing cancer cells as well. That's something that's being investigated. It may not go anywhere, but if it does, then it's important to know that's the case. Plus, the higher the ketones, the lower the glucose. Not so important in performance, but definitely more important for people with cancer.
Yeah, exactly. Now, people are probably scratching their heads right now and wondering, where are the ketones bodies actually created within us?
Primarily in the liver. There are some that are created in the kidney as well, but the ones that we talk about in a ketogenic diet for cancer are being converted within cells in the liver.
So then I'm assuming then liver support is very important then during the procedure for therapeutic usage.
Actually, our bodies do pretty well if we have a healthy liver to start with. But that is one of the things I really need to look at with each new client. And I also, you know, whenever I just give general information, it's about healthy liver. Elevated liver enzymes need to be dealt with. There are certain things like you may have heard that medium chain triglyceride oil, MCT oil, is very ketogenic. Well, this is true, but I have some problems with using it with people who have active liver disease, whether it's, you know, cancer or cirrhosis or just the effect of the chemotherapy drugs. Generally, that's what it is, the effect of the chemotherapy drugs on the liver, because all those drugs have to be detoxed by the liver. And in that process, they do cause some damage.
Fascinating. Why don't we do a quick rundown? Because people are probably wondering, you know, what is, for example, let's walk through a standard day through your therapeutic procedure for the ketogenic diet. Just for example, what would you have for a breakfast, lunch, and dinner?
Oh, okay. What people start with and what they may end up with in a few months can be very different. But what I do is I get information, first of all, about food preferences. And so if this was not in somebody's food preferences, then I wouldn't be including it. But a really kind of general way to approach this would be a spinach omelet for breakfast. So you would have 2 to 3 eggs, depending on your size and your protein needs. You'd melt a little bit of butter and add it to the beaten egg and use that to, you know, scramble the egg or do it for the omelet. If you were using cheese, you'd use a little bit of cheese in the omelet. You'd take some spinach and saute it in olive oil and maybe even a slice of tomato, and there's breakfast. You may... If you need more fat, you may need to find another way to get fat in. But right in that breakfast, you have the fat from the eggs, coming from the eggs. You have the fat from the butter that you've added in, and you have the fat from the olive oil. So for a lot of people, that would be sufficient. So then for lunch, you could have a Caesar salad, a chicken or sardine, whichever you prefer. So 2-3 cups of romaine lettuce. A relatively small portion of protein. We're talking about keeping protein adequate, but not excessive, because excessive protein has a couple of different ways it can be utilized by cancer cells. So for a lot of my clients, that would be about a portion of chicken that was about 2/3 the size of a deck of cards. So they have this romaine, they have the chicken. If they want some grated Parmesan for a little flavoring, some grated Parmesan, an olive oil dressing, whether it's straight olive oil or mixed with vinegar, but no balsamic or malt vinegar, please. And then a half an avocado. And for most people, that's a decent lunch. A dinner could vary quite a bit, but one that I know a lot of people like is salmon and asparagus. So you prepare the salmon. Again, in that case, it's about 2/3 the size of a checkbook, would be adequate protein for the average person. And asparagus, you can either saute it in olive oil, or you can steam it and then either drizzle it with olive oil or butter. You can could take some mayonnaise and add some fresh dill to it and use that with the salmon. So there's a number of different ways to work the fats in.
Amazing. Sounds like my day.
Well, it's a very good eating plan. And even for a family where not everyone is going to be on this kind of a plan, that's the basics. And maybe the non-keto people at dinner have some type of starch with that. Maybe they have some brown rice with the salmon as well. But, you know, we don't need tons. I don't follow a strict ketogenic diet. I'm more like the Volokh and Finney, where I limit the amount of carbs that I take in. And I don't really worry about being whether or not I'm in ketosis, but I don't have a cancer diagnosis. Mm. All the rules change when you get that cancer diagnosis.
Definitely. Now, by following the ketogenic diet, is there anything else in conjunction you couple that with? For example, some different lifestyle changes or maybe some different types of supplementations or medications that you have seen in your practice that actually do very well for people?
You know, there are a number of them, and the ones that are proving to be non-toxic and sort of will eventually be best practice, hyperbaric oxygen, not appropriate for everybody, but in models of metastatic disease, Dominic D'Agostino at the University of South Florida, he and Tom Seyfried designed a study using hyperbaric oxygen. Well, we all know from past research that hyperbaric oxygen on its own does nothing for cancer. But these mice in the study were on a ketogenic diet, and the combination of ketogenic diet and hyperbaric oxygen did improve their survival. So that's one therapy. Some other therapies would be finding ways to increase the level of ketones, which would also be help to make the hyperbaric oxygen more therapeutic too. But there are ways to increase ketone levels that are separate from diet. There's ketone esters, there's ketone salts, there's a couple of them. I don't work with those. Unless somebody is working with a doctor that is familiar with these things, but it's not like I say to people, well, you really should be doing this, that, or the other thing. I really can't go there. But one thing I can say is that there's some very interesting research on plain old baking soda, sodium bicarbonate. Mm. And sodium bicarbonate, it has been shown in some studies, a couple of studies that appear pretty sound, to raise the pH of the extracellular space around tumors. And we all know that those spaces are acidic. Some people think that we're talking about whole body acidity here, and we're not. We're talking about that extracellular space around the tumor. And baking soda it may actually have some impact there in raising the pH and slowing down the action of tumors in terms of.
Yeah, have you heard about that doctor in Italy? He's the, I forget his name, but he's been claiming that he's been curing many of his patients through injections of baking soda directly on the tumor within and the cancer cell.
You know, and I have read that with interest. His premise is that the cancer is a fungus, mm-hmm. and I don't understand that part of it, but I do understand why what he's doing might be an effective therapy. I've only discovered this connection with baking soda about 3 weeks ago when I was looking at ways to make one of my clients to help him with the acidity of his urine. He wanted it to be more alkaline, and baking soda does make your urine more alkaline. So we were using that. And I came across this other research that I found very interesting. There's a lot of other things. There's a compound called dichloroacetate. It has its proponents, but it also has its detractors. There's a number of.
What's your take on the magnesium therapy? A lot of people are doing like even high bolus dosages for like intravenous.
Magnesium certainly has a place. You need to be careful with magnesium. That should only be done with a doctor who can monitor the outcomes. And magnesium also for people with kidney disease would not be a smart move. I recommend magnesium supplementation to absolutely every person I work with. I ask them to clear it with their doctor, and we use different types depending on what the need is. Because, you know, most basically, people can use magnesium if they're constipated, and a lot of chemo treatments are constipating. Mm-hmm. So they can use it in that sense, and they wouldn't use as readily an absorbable form of magnesium. They'd use something like oxide or magnesium citrate. There's even quite a bit of magnesium in Perrier. Mm-hmm. So if somebody just wanted to start there. But yeah, I do feel it's important, maybe not as a cancer treatment, but on supporting normal function in the body, bone, mineralization. There's a number of features. People who have leg cramps during the night are aided by magnesium supplementation. I personally use a slow mag, that's magnesium chloride. And if I need more, then I'll use a magnesium oxide. I know people use chelates and aspartates, and there's a lot of really interesting information online about those.
Definitely. Now, we were talking about earlier about the mitochondria. Do you focus on rebalancing mitochondrial energy pathways? So is there any certain supplementations you'd use or certain direct protocols within the ketogenic diet to maximize how your mitochondria functions?
I haven't gotten there yet. What I see as the support is that ketones. Let me back up a little bit. Mitochondria are dysfunctional in cancer. We all know that now. We recognize that as true. Mitochondria are dysfunctional. What seems to happen over time with a ketogenic diet is these cells that are sort of living in a less differentiated state, they've sort of reverted, they're less differentiated, which is part of the reason why they proliferate. Less differentiated cells have a higher proliferation rate. It's also one of the reasons why they don't recognize themselves as damaged and kill themselves off, because they're in this less differentiated state, more similar to a stem cell than a healthy cell. So over time, they either get better or they die off. And if they get better, they become more differentiated. So I think that's what you might be talking about with mitochondrial repair. So they become more differentiated, more similar once again to the normal tissue that they should be. And when they become more differentiated, they are more likely to recognize themselves as damaged and create that, do that self-suicide. So we see that with, I think that shows up pretty clearly when you have a 3-month span and you have one scan to the next and you see some definite changes. It's not just about reduction in the tumor, but I've actually known some of my clients who have had repeat biopsies, and they get a different read, a less aggressive, different read on that second biopsy post KD initiation than they originally had. And I find that just amazing. Mm-hmm. And that I just hope that the medical world that is tracking these folks that this is happening for are starting to recognize that this isn't just an aberration, or maybe they didn't get they were looking at a different area of the tumor, but that there might actually be structural changes within the tumor that are moving it to a less aggressive, more healthy state rather than always moving towards, more malignancy.
Well, that's kind of my kind of beef I have right now at the moment is, it's not like the ketogenic diet is something new. It's been around for a very long time. In fact, has been used therapeutically for a while. And, the science is here, as you're saying. It's right there in front of our faces. And even if you don't believe in science, you have people in front of you who testify that it works. Like, even if you don't believe in scientific research or you don't understand it, there are human beings out there who have transformed their lives on this diet. And,
yes.
And just begs the question then is like, why is there so much aggression towards it or hatred or fear towards something? Honestly, if you look at it in the grand scheme of things, it's so simple. It's not very complicated. You just mentioned earlier what you have for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. That's not hard. Majority of the world already eats that.
Right. If they're fortunate enough to live in a country that has access and they have the money to buy these foods, then, you know, yeah, that's absolutely true. I think that the pushback in the developed world is more about what we have taken as this snapshot in time. And the time, it is just still a snapshot. But if you look over the last 100 years, where we've come from, believing that fat is so evil and that carbohydrates are good for us, I think universally we understand that diet should be limited in the amount of refined carbohydrate and sugar. But the guidelines for Americans say that you could get up to 25%. Of your calories per day from added sugars. And to me, that's crazy. And when you dig a little deeper, Ameer, what you find is that they just have so little faith in us as people in being able to eliminate these foods from our diet, that rather than setting these what they view as unattainable lifestyle changes, they just allow for the least common denominator there, and assume that you're going to do that. But I am fortunate enough to come across people who are just sincerely interested in making this not just about a diet, and that it's a lifestyle. And I need to stress that, because one of the questions I get asked a lot is, well, how long do I have to stay on this diet? And it's like, well, no, this isn't a diet. If this is working for you, you're going to feel so much better. Well, I've tried it before and I was hungry on it. Well, if you're hungry on a ketogenic diet, there was something wrong in the implementation of it, because ketones suppress hunger. So either there's something wrong with you metabolically that's not being addressed by the diet, or you were doing something, and it can be this simple. Somebody drinks a glass of milk at every meal. They don't understand that milk has carbohydrate in it. They think of sugar. Well, it doesn't have sugar, is what they're thinking. Well, it has lactose in it. Fruit, oranges, fruit has fructose in it. So, these things are really important when you're doing when you're wanting to follow a ketogenic diet. Boy, you better have that down of what the foods are that you need to eliminate from your diet. So once you eliminate those foods, once they're not in your world anymore and you're feeling better, why would you go back to eating them?
Yeah, exactly. It's like you mentioned, it's a lifestyle change. And I can attest to that. When I'm pretty much like seasonal ketogenic. So I'm ketogenic right now during the wintertime. And, my health transformed when I approached that type of lifestyle. But where do you see, where would you like to see the ketogenic diet go in the world of, say, cancer?
Oh, well, I would like to see clinics. I think that people need to feel supported. I think if you're doing this for weight loss, there's a lot of online forums and there's a lot of information, and a lot of your friends might be doing this at the same time, going low carb. But if you're doing this for cancer, you're living in, as a woman I spoke to recently said, when you go to the hospital, she calls it the fear factory. And so you're living in this world of experts, and you're expected to be a spectator. And it's a spectator sport. You are given this cancer diagnosis, and now you have a protocol to follow, and you're not expected to question that. Where else does that happen in our lives that we're not expected to question? Not many places. And I'm not saying throw it all out the window. I'm saying use it judiciously. See what you can get. Get the best out of allopathic, and get the best out of alternative. And combine them at a place where you feel comfortable. Because after all, if you're not comfortable doing this, if you're fearful doing this, then you shouldn't be doing it. Or you should be easing into it so gently. I've had people who were so fearful of it that all we do in the beginning is add fat. Mm. then they see, okay, I can do some fat. And then I say, well, what food, you know, can you just throw out? Can you just pull all sugar out? I mean, how easy would that be for you right now? And as they move along the path, these other steps become more and more doable, and there's less fear associated with it. A lot of people tell me their doctors don't want them to do it because they're afraid of losing weight. And yes, in the world of advanced cancer, cachexia, which is that, you know, that whole, that wasting syndrome associated with the end of life, cachexia is a really big deal. And you, these doctors, you want to keep weight on people for that period of time at end of life, just to sustain them for a little bit longer. But what they don't understand is in that advice to people not to lose weight, that people are seeking all of these easily digestible carbohydrates. They're being told, eat anything you want. So, because doctors don't want you to have to make this lifestyle change. You got enough on your plate with coming for chemo every week and all the other things you're dealing with. So don't make any dietary changes. So, you know, the clinics that would be supportive, and that, and I don't mean isolated integrative centers. I'm talking about within, you know, within a normal hospital. To be able to support somebody who wants to do this alongside a standard of care, that's the first place that's where it's going to make the most impact in the medical world. It's already making a huge impact in the alternative world because they don't have those constraints on them. But doctors want evidence-based.
Well, now, I think the evidence is here.
Well, but it hasn't run the gauntlet of the clinical trials. It hasn't done the phase 1, 2, 3. It's enormously expensive to put a diet through that. The protocols that I've seen for ketogenic diet in clinical trials are they have some issues to them that are going to be problematic when it gets to the, you know, the endpoints. So start with a clinic where you're supporting somebody in a lifestyle choice. Think of it that way, and allow people, allow them, give them the freedom to participate in their in moving in a direction that they think will build health instead of stomping on it. You know what? I have a big problem with the way some doctors interact with their patients. They'll roll their eyes, they'll rant, they'll bully, they'll intimidate. And then that person comes away fearful and will come back and say to me, my doctor said I can't do this, or, you know, he won't let me. And as you know, it's not about your doctor can't, you know, what is he, the food police? He's not in your home telling you what you can eat. You know, if he understood about this diet, it may not be as, you know, he may not have the objections to it. I think it's just his lack of curiosity or her lack of curiosity that keeps him there. Nutrition's not taught in medical school. It's just pushed off to registered dietitians, and most registered dietitians want to follow the evidence-based, so-called evidence-based guidelines. But when you start to pick those apart, like Gary Taubes has done, when you start to pick apart where those came from, there really is no evidence for our evidence-based guidelines in nutrition.
No, you're right. Everything's it's a farce at the end of the day, as everything's created for a monopoly of monetization of profits.
Yeah, and I think if people just go in empowered, saying, well, you know, just I'm going to do this anyway. I'm gonna do what you're saying, but I'm gonna do this anyway, and let's just see what happens. And that's I don't want people to form confrontation. You know, I don't want them to go in and insist to their doctor that they're. So if you have a doctor that's eye rolling and bullying you and intimidating you, look around. There's another doctor in that group that doesn't behave like that. So why not, within the same oncology group, why not pick a doctor who is going to support your move to health, who's going to see this as do no harm and not pose additional challenges for you? You got a cancer diagnosis. You're already pretty challenged. You know, this is the way to start. Consumer-driven is the way to start. if people go in, you know, firm in their belief that this is what they want to do, then you're looking at consumer driven rather than waiting for it to trickle down through these clinical trials. People with cancer don't have that luxury. They have it here and now. These trials 10 years from now, maybe we'll give some data back. They don't have that 10 years. They need to do this now.
Yeah, I agree 100%. You know, it's take action now. And like you said, if you have a doctor or whoever your practitioner is that you're dealing with is doing that to you, rolling their eyes and being a jackass, to be frank, you know, you don't deserve that. You deserve a good doctor, and go find yourself somebody. Because like you said, for probably every one, you know, jackass doctor, there's really a genuine, nice doctor that really cares about you, and he or she will do their best to help you out.
Usually in that same group, Ameer, it's not even that you don't even have to switch hospitals. You just look around and pick a doctor in that same group, and you are allowed to do that. You are in charge of your healthcare. You do make these decisions. You know, just think about a clinical trial and the, you know, 14, 20 pages of information that you have to read and sign off on to enter a clinical trial. It's all about your choice. You choose to be there. And you can choose to revoke that at any point. Well, you can choose the doctor that you want to work with in your care. And it's a really important choice. It's not like picking a pair of shoes. No, this is something that you got to live with.
Yeah, isn't that the truth? So if you had to summarize, then what would you tell, like a suggestion or a tip? I call it my optimal health tip. If you had like one sentence to summarize to somebody who may be going through cancer or who may be thinking about entering the ketogenic diet, is there any types of tips or suggestions you can give that individual?
It depends on where they're coming from and what their background is. But if I were to sum it up, I would say just be informed. Look for the most credible sources that you can. Those are coming out of the research world. The credible sources are in the research world. And once you understand on any level the science behind the diet, then you can build on that in the future. But start with the basics. Ellen Davis. Probably know Ellen Davis. She's written an ebook on the science. Mine is on the implementation. And if you can put those two together and then take a look at Thomas Seyfried's work, it's just his book is just amazing. But it requires some background before you
Oh yeah, it's a heavy duty book.
it's a pretty heavy duty book. But what I really love is go online and Dr. Seyfried did a really good presentation on the Ancestral Health Symposium it was posted in January. It was actually August the year before, but it was posted this past January. So you know, look at that. It's brief and it sums it up nicely. Dominic D'Agostino did an interview with Dr. Mercola that I really like, where they went over hyperbaric oxygen and the ketogenic diet. That's a good quick-paced one that you can find online. And you know, just follow these people. Follow the websites that have the credible information posted. Be careful in this world, because there are a lot of people claiming cures. They're claiming cures that I think genuinely aren't happening. And I think there's just some, I don't think it's deliberate. I don't think they're trying to present it. But by saying the ketogenic diet is a cure, some people delay looking at other alternatives that might complement the diet and rely solely on the diet. And I warn people about that.
True wisdom. I couldn't agree more. So, Miriam, where can people find you? Your email or your website? How they can reach you?
Well, my website's the best place. Dietary Therapies is my website.
And you also have an ebook, right?
Yes, as of this week, finally. But it comes from working with hundreds of people and having the same questions come up and the same, like a the same kinds of troubleshooting that we go through. It's this is good information. And I think the more people read about it, the less frightening it becomes to think about changing a lifestyle. Really, you know, our son changed our lives because we were just, we were solidly in the standard diet world. We didn't eat a lot of sugar, but, you know, we did eat a lot of carbohydrates. And then when we made this change for him, we made the change for ourselves as well. And boy, what an eye-opener that was about how much better both my husband and I felt by cutting that stuff out of our diet. So it's like taking a shower. I mean, you take a shower because it feels good, not just for the benefit to other people, but because it feels good. So why wouldn't you want to make a change in your lifestyle, like a diet, that that will make you feel good? It's not as difficult as people think. You just got to break it down into manageable steps. You got to start at the point you're comfortable with and move to the next place.
There you have it. I couldn't agree more, 100%. Well, I want to thank you so much for coming on the show today and educating our audience about the importance of a ketogenic diet, and it holds great promise, you know, towards cancer and tumors and metabolic issues in general. Once again, Miriam, thank you so much for coming on the show, and have an amazing day.
Thank you, Ameer. Thank you so much for having me on
your
show.
My pleasure.
All right. Take care.